He remains a century later the greatest baseball player of all time. When President Trump awarded Babe Ruth a long overdue Medal of Freedom this year, he said he should have gotten it a long time ago. And this photo of the Babe went viral earlier this year, giving his signed autobiography to the then captain of the Yale baseball team. That would be one George Herbert Walker Bush. But beyond Ruth's baseball legend, 714 home runs, 4 World Series titles, a slugging percentage that nobody has ever topped, most people don't know many of the stories about the man. His tough childhood, his frequent trips to orphanages and hospitals, and kindness to black ballplayers. And when he was dying of cancer, December 1947, he dressed up as Santa Claus and met with children who themselves were suffering from polio. Watch this.
I want a rabbit.
You want a rabbit?
Yeah.
A rabbit. Oh, now, how can I get a rabbit? I'll give you one of these nice shoes until we get a rabbit for you.
Okay.
Maybe we'll think about the rabbit later.
Thank you.
These whiskers are getting me down.
All these aspects of the man explored in a fascinating new best-selling biography, The Big Fella, Babe Ruth and the World He Created. The author, Jane Levy, joins me now. She was staff writer at The Washington Post and has also written best-selling biographies of Mickey Mantle and Sandy Koufax, which is why it's a good thing that her grandmother grew up in the shadow of the real Yankee Stadium. Am I right, Jane?
Yeah, she lived a long, loud foul ball from the real original Yankee Stadium.
I said this to you on radio, and it's true. I took my own sons to see a Phillies game when the Giants were in town, Barry Bonds, a lot of controversy, and somebody in left field had a sign that said, Babe got it done with beer and hot dogs. Is that true?
Yeah, it is. And the thing about the hot dogs is, you know, the reform school that he spent his childhood at, which was called St. Mary's Industrial School on the western cusp of Baltimore City, gave the kids meat only once a week. What do you think it was? Hot dogs. It is absolutely no surprise to me that he would gorge himself on them for the rest of his life.
I'm nonetheless, I mean, well aware of your success. I'm nonetheless stunned by the fact that you thought there was new ground to be plowed. What made you think that even Jane Levy could write a book that would be a best-selling autobiography of a man about whom so much is, or biography, that so much has already been written about?
I wasn't sure that there was. So I spent a year before signing on to do it, reading everything that had been written about him, all the very good biographies that had come before. But what was missing from all of them was the first 20 years of his life. It was as if he stepped fully fledged out of St. Mary's Industrial School into an Orioles uniform in 1914. And when something's missing like that from everywhere, as a reporter, you know there's a story that hasn't been told that needs to be told. And to understand the big
fella, what was the eureka moment?
The eureka moment was probably when his daughter, Julia Ruth Stevens, who's now 102, told me that his parents had been separated. And she said, well, I just thought everybody knew. Well, of course, nobody knew. And Babe Ruth had good reason for hiding it. In fact, his parents were divorced, and it was a very ugly divorce. And the reason he was sent to St. Mary's had nothing to do with him being incorrigible, nothing to do with him being an orphan. He was unwanted, and after his parents' divorce, his father just sent him away.
Can I say that the book is as much about celebrity as it is about Babe Ruth? And here's a lawyer's question. I don't know if you can see me. I'm holding a Baby Ruth bar. How could he not get paid? How could he not get paid for this?
So Babe Ruth was the model for modern celebrity. He comes along just at the moment when technology and marketing and PR conspire to amplify and redefine his fame. But he was so far ahead of everybody else that there was no law to protect him, no right of publicity, as it is called. That came around in 1951. So that when the Curtis Candy Company decided to rename their candy cake Baby Ruth and argue implausibly that it was named after Grover Cleveland's dead daughter, Baby Ruth, who I think had died in 1904, he had no venue. There was no way for the law to make him whole. He tried to file suit in patent court, and he failed. And so he never made a dime off the candy bar, the most successful nickel bar in history that everybody still assumes was named for him.
Jane Levy continued success with yet another bestseller.
Thank you so much, Michael. Happy holidays.